I have acquired or learned 10 languages in my life, and currently speak 5 of them fluently. I specifically use the term acquired versus learning because there is a difference, and I will tell you at the end of this video about how this concept applies to my languages, and more importantly, to raising my kids in multiple languages. But first, the funky stuff. Let me tell you about my 10 languages using my 10 languages. Welcome to Ask Tetsu, where we unlock the world's opportunities for our children by teaching them languages. My name is Tetsu. I have been raised in many languages, and today I am raising my own 4 kids in 5 languages. If you are new here, I urge you to subscribe and follow our kids' language development journey. Alright, today I am showing off. Nah, I'm not a big fan of doing circus shows with my languages, but I do want to tell you the stories to each of my languages to illustrate the concept of language acquisition versus language learning, and hope to convince you to focus on teaching your kids languages as early as possible in life, where most of the natural language acquisition takes place. Again, I will explain what I mean by that later, but first, let's get into my stories, starting with Mandarin Chinese. 那我小时候是在台湾长大的，我父亲是台湾人，母亲是日本人，所以我从小就跟我老爸讲中文，然后跟我妈妈讲日文。那我在台湾还有学到两种台湾的语言，第一个是台湾话，另外一个是客家话。其实这两种语言我都是只是听得懂，但是讲不太出来。我会说的都是非常基本的东西了，或者是脏话。人家是问我。
欸，你会晓讲台语无？我最喜欢回答的就是啊，我听有啦，但是不晓讲啦。所以常常跟计程车司机，我聊起来的时候，他们会跟我用台湾话，而我就用国语回答。欸，你去倒位啊？我去台北转运站。欸，你是日本人哦？欸，我在台湾长大，但是我父亲是台湾人，母亲是日本人。 哦，哎，恁今仔真够水呢！哎，谢谢谢谢，要不要他讲五种语言给你听？等等等等，哎，那我为什么也会一点客家话呢？这是因为我父亲是客家人，所以我公公婆婆姑姑叔叔他们都是讲客家话的，所以跟台湾话也是差不多，都是听得懂，但是讲不出多少。你唐也是嘛？哎，唐也是啊，不会讲了。 那会讲的也是一样，都是最基本的东西啊。え、シュパーマー、天光に降ろすいま、あ、降ろすいも、あんらんお、え、ヘマニン等等啊。さて、日本語に移りましょう。私は台湾で育ったにもかかわらず、日本語が話せるのは母と日本語で話す以外にも、え、日本語の漫画やテレビ番組、え、そういうビデオをいっぱい見てたからです。 さらに毎年の夏休みは日本のおばあちゃんのところにも行かせてもらって、そこでも相当強化されました。これでもね、日本の学校や補習校などは一切通ったことはないです。で、日本語検定試験も一応1級は取らせていただきました。あざっす。As for my English, my parents sent me to an American elementary school in Taipei. So, that's quite straightforward. But as a consequence, even though I grew up in Taiwan and speak fluent Mandarin and Japanese, I am unable to write Chinese characters with my own hands. But thankfully, I am able to read, so with the advent of word processors and computers, this handicap is no longer a problem at all, as I can now type anything I want in both Chinese and Japanese. Alors, on va changer au français. Après mon école primaire à Taiwan, à l'âge de 13 ans, mes parents m'ont envoyé étudier au Canada. Dans la province du Québec. Donc, l'accent que vous entendez présentement. Je peux essayer d'imiter les Français de France, mais les Français me disent toujours « Là là, vous l'avez pas du tout, là !» Et c'est vrai, je l'ai vraiment pas. Mais bon, pour finir avec l'histoire de mon français, suffit de dire que cette langue est devenue extrêmement importante dans ma vie. Par après, étant donné que toute ma famille a decidido de venir a instalar en Quebec algunas años después de mi arrivée. Bueno, ahora cambiamos al español. Después de mi secundaria, o prepa, como dicen los mexicanos, he tenido la oportunidad de visitar a un buen amigo canadiense que fue a estudiar en Ecuador. Así que, por la primera vez en mi vida, a los 18 años, decidí estudiar un idioma solamente, únicamente y nada más por interés. Me compré casetes, no CD, casetes con su librito de gramática. Y pasé horas y horas escuchándolos, comiendo, lavando los trastes, en el gimnasio, durmiendo. Y mis amigos se volvían locos cuando entraban en mi carro y oían, repeat after me, ¿dónde está la estación? Bueno, claro que no he aprendido todo mi español con casetes, pero seguramente me han dado bastante conocimientos para poder discutir de cosas sencillas con los ecuatorianos durante mi corta estancia. Y luego en Canadá hice muchos amigos latinos que me han enseñado muchas cosas importantes de la vida y también he viajado mucho a otros países hispanohablantes como Cuba, República Dominicana, Perú, Costa Rica, España, etcétera, etcétera. Hasta que llegué a un nivel bastante alto para poder de vez en cuando tener trabajo voluntario o pagado como traductor o intérprete. Ok, sprechen wir ein bisschen auf Deutsch, ja? Fangen wir an. Nach meinem spanischen Erfolg, ich dachte, ich wäre ein Wunderkind der Sprache. Oder ich hätte ein besonderes Talent für Sprachen. Aber nein. Deutsch hat mir sehr schnell das Gegenteil bewiesen. Ich habe 2 Deutschkurse an der Universität genommen, aber ich habe fast alles vergessen. Allora, col mio orgoglio distrutto per il tedesco, pensavo di potermi riprendere con l'italiano, perché pensavo che sarebbe stato relativamente semplice, dato che già parlavo francese e spagnolo. Quindi ho seguito un corso di italiano, ma non è stato facile come avevo sperato. È certo che c'erano parole molto facili come mangiare, che è come manger in francese, o acqua, che è come agua in spagnolo. Ma ci sono anche molte parole di uso giornaliero che sono uniche all'italiano come stanza o svegliare, che non possono essere indovinati dalle altre lingue che parlo. Quindi oggi non direi che parlo bene l'italiano. Finalmente o português, minha 10ª lingua. Foi simplesmente aprendido viajando para Portugal e Brasil. Ao contrário do italiano, que tinha muitas diferenças com o espanhol e o francês, o português estava muito próximo do espanhol na forma escrita. O que foi muito diferente foi a pronúncia, mas mesmo esses eram relativamente fáceis quando você lembra dos padrões. Mas nunca estudei português ativamente, portanto, claramente não está na categoria fluente da minha lista de idiomas. So there you go, you now know the stories to each of my 10 languages. Now, obviously I don't speak all of them fluently, as you've seen, and I admit I got some help from Google Translate for some items. So, I don't intend on talking about the specific levels of each of my languages here, but rather I want to come back to defining language acquisition versus language learning, which I had mentioned at the start of the video. Stephen Krashen, the world's top authority in language acquisition with his input hypothesis, famously defined language acquisition as the subconscious acceptance of knowledge. This can mostly be done through communication, which is basically the process for native language development. But Krashen also emphasizes reading or listening, that is, input, especially things that you like, which he calls free voluntary reading or listening. Language learning, on the other hand, is the conscious acceptance of knowledge about a language, that is, grammar or form, which is basically the process of typical formal language instruction. Now, interestingly, all of my fluent languages, so that's English, French, Japanese, Mandarin, and Spanish, were, I would say, acquired, or at least most of it acquired. For example, for Spanish, I did study the grammar a little bit at the beginning, so this part is learned, but after that, all I did was purely using the languages. A lot of voluntary reading, which is at the core of Krashen's input hypothesis, and a lot of communicating, or some may say, partying. Another interesting observation is from my Taiwanese and Hakka. I can't actively speak these languages fluently, but I do understand a lot of what is being said. So I am what is called a passive speaker in Taiwanese and Hakka. In fact, I believe I would still understand much more of the spoken Taiwanese or Hakka compared to German or Italian. And both of these languages I had learned by successfully completing intermediate courses at the university level, with pretty good grades too. So long story short, I think language acquisition trumps language learning any day of the week, in my humble opinion. And even though I believe adults can acquire languages also, this process is much more natural and successful in children. I mean, just look around you. So if you have kids and want them to speak new languages, I urge you to teach them when they are young. For more information on Crashen's teachings, if you're watching this on YouTube, please check out the video in that corner over there where I talk about how the input hypothesis can be applied to having your kids watch TV. And if you are interested in watching our kids speak different languages, please check out the playlist right below this window. Otherwise, don't forget to subscribe to catch our latest language adventures, and I'll catch you in the next video.